Okay, so we are a church that likes to gather and scatter. If you're a guest of this, we're thrilled that you're here. Our conviction is that God is looking for a people, not who will simply do this together, but who will matter in their community. Our way of thinking about it is that we want to be the type of movement that the most ardent critic of Christianity would be bummed if we ceased to exist, because we think Jesus wants to matter to people in very concrete ways and in our community. Our conviction, I suppose, is that most people don't need to hear Jesus' claims, but they need to see it with skin on. And so we talk constantly about gathering and scattering and this being a catalyst to that. And to that end, the 30 so of you, 30 or so, I can't talk, the donut, like between services, I never eat the between services meals because they're always bad news, but I'm like, I'm not teaching this weekend, I can have the donut. And I was sitting there during the whole set going like, ugh, why did I eat the donut? So, I don't know what I was saying other than to say thank you to the 30 or so of you who helped gather on Mount Helena yesterday, and we did not have the cops called on us, which is an accomplishment, and we even saw people with spandex, but no cops, so it was a successful endeavor to that end. Amalgamate and calf, or acclimate, that's his thing tonight. My friend, last service I called him a wino. He's not a wino. He likes wine. He's a connoisseur of wine. So it's going to be wine and cheese and milk and cheesecake or whatever you prefer there. But really the design of the gathering is a platform for those of you that are new to the culture around here. New is a relative term. You get to decide what it means. But just have questions about who we are and what we're about. And so we'll sit down in the living room. We'll have a little conversation, mostly you talking, not me at all. So if you want to be a part of that, there's a sign-up sheet out in the lobby. If it says it's full, it's not, just sign your name there, we'll get you in, that's kind of the way we roll, but anyway, unless there's like four names and then don't, and now I'm confusing you. So we can get you in if you want in. Okay, so I was thinking during the first service that about a year ago I sent off this email to my friend Rob, and actually sent it off because my wife was flying out to Portland to spend my last trip to George Fox in Portland. She was flying out to hang out with me, and she went to sit down in her seat in the airplane, and there was Rob Griggs, who was her youth pastor and also the guy who performed our wedding ceremony. And it's also the guy, if I've done your wedding ceremony, that I learned the line, I don't know if any of you, I don't see anybody in the room, but, so I always say to people in the rehearsal, now, if the kiss is too short, nobody will think it's going to stick, and if it's too long, you'll scare the kids. And typically couples look at me and roll their eyes because it's kind of juvenile, but I learned it from Rob at my very own wedding rehearsal. So I sent this email to him about after that incident where Teresa sat down on the plane next to him and just said, hey, would you ever want to come to Narrate and teach? He's a guy, one of my very favorite local communicators, and he responded, yes. And I sent like, really? And he said, yes. And so you remember that he was here in August. And then I tried it again, like, hey, would you want to come back to Narrate? And he said, yes. And so it's our privilege to have Rob. But before you welcome him, we're going to welcome him with a video.
You ever notice how easy it is to become careless with our lives? Little decisions that we make, they don't seem to amount to much. After all, they're just small things. After a while, these bad decisions become so common we don't even notice them anymore. And pretty soon, they've added up. So maybe we make the decision to stop doing these things, to change our behavior, and to do life differently. Some are easy to change, others are a lot harder and take more time. But no matter if it's easy or hard to change, often there is damage that's been done, and all we have left to show for it are marks and scars. What do you do then? Well, good morning. Nice to be with you guys today. Something that you probably observed in that video that was pointed out to me first time a group saw it is that I hammer nails like a girl. Now, I know that the girls in here are offended by that because you can all hammer nails a lot better than I can. So please try not to take offense at that. That also reminds me of, when you watch yourself on video, it's like hearing your voice recorded. You know that weird thing you go through? That's not really what I sound like. And as I watch myself, you know, mangling this board with a hammer and nail, I am the least gifted guy in the world when it comes to home improvement. And my wife, you know, we've been married for 26 years now, and her brothers are both, you know, really gifted in this. And so anytime they have a project at the house, come over, they kind of, yeah, little sister will take care of it. They look at me like, we hate you. You're useless. You know, we're doing all of your work. My middle brother-in-law, her brother that's very handy, works at one of the great big home improvement stores in Billings. And, you know, I called him one day, yeah, the drain's dripping in the kitchen, I can't, And he says, well, you're going to have to bring me the drain so we can take a look at the gasket and see how that works. Well, you know, I'm looking at the thing, figuring, I don't know, I don't even know how this works. Half an hour later, I come walking through the front door, carrying the whole sink, hoses dripping, dragging behind me. Thump, you know, and he's just like taking a break. He's like, I don't even know this guy. So it's broken. Oh. And so, but I digress, and that has virtually nothing to do with what I'm going to talk about today. you know, the thing is, and I love listening to Adam teach. I love the authenticity, and it's always challenging in a fresh way for me. And I love the way, even in this last service, that the whole DNA of Narrate Church is that, you know, we can talk about things, but it's always under the umbrella of God's tremendous grace and love and affection for us. And you're never going to get poked in the chest by a bony finger from heaven that's telling you all the things you're doing wrong. And, you know, I don't know about you, but I know all the things I'm doing wrong. Aren't you a pretty good expert on all your failures and shortcomings as well? Probably. So this message is going to be kind of fun because we're going to talk about consequences. And coming clean with our mistakes to where consequences come into play, but recognizing that happening in such a way that God meets us in the middle of that and actually embraces us and helps us with it. So what does it, what happens when you own consequences? I mean, what is that supposed to look like in our lives? I heard about a pastor's roundtable where they were discussing a young man who went on a business trip, and he came back home, found his pastor the next day, and told him this story. He said, I went on this business trip with a female colleague. We stayed in the bar a little too late. I had a little too much to drink, and one thing led to another, and we wound up in bed together. And so now I'm here this morning with my pastor of many years, and I want to know, what do I do next? What do I do now? And so the pastor knew this young man grew up in the church, and so he was trying to speak to him in a biblical sense, and he said, well, the four things you need to be concerned with, first of all, have you talked to God about this? Have you come clean with God and asked his forgiveness? The second thing is, have you communicated with the woman that this was a mistake and apologized to her and tell her that in no way, shape, or form this will ever happen again? And then have you told your wife about this and confessed to her and invited her forgiveness and involvement in the process right now? And if you haven't done that, have you at least called the clinic to set up an appointment to be tested for AIDS or an STD so you don't carry that into the marriage bed and affect her life and the life of your unborn child? And after the pastor finished, the young man was listening without any expression, and he folded his arms and he said, I came here for grace, not for discipline. You disappoint me, pastor. And so the pastor's talking with these other leaders, and they're trying to figure out, how does a guy that grows up in the church, that's heard this before, confuse the grace and the love and the mercy of God with an erasure or an absence of consequences? How did those two things get mixed up? And, you know, you think about it, we're in a culture right now that, by and large, works really hard to try to cover our mistakes and try not to take any blame for it. How many of you ever watch a reality show or TMZ? These programs are all geared toward us sitting around laughing at these failed celebrities or people making mistakes or making, fools out of themselves. And there's just a culture right now that says, boy, we've got to do everything we can to make sure that we never are seen to be at fault. And if we are, we've got to find a legal way or some kind of a creative way to pass the buck and make it somebody else's responsibility. It's a very litigious society that we live in. A lot of frivolous lawsuits. And I'm all for the legal system. I think it's the best in the world. But obviously we're in a culture right now where people want to pass the buck and they don't want to own their own mistakes. And so I want to talk about it in a context today of the fact that God knows us better than we know ourselves. And he knows that we're going to make more mistakes than we even realize. He already bought into that from the cross. You know, he already decided to love you and to invite you into relationship, knowing full well that you are going to make a complete mess out of your life from time to time, just like I have and will continue to, and loves us in spite of that, and also wants to be involved in how we process facing some of the consequences of our life. You'd be familiar with the name Bernie Madoff. Here's a guy that, bilked investors out of what, like $65 billion over the course of 15, 20 years, is serving a 150-year life sentence. And I heard just last week on the news that he is still unable to admit full culpability for what he did. It's always somebody else's fault. Now, this time he's telling the feds it was the banks. The banks knew all along what was going on. They could have stopped this at any time. So don't blame me. It's the bank's fault, you know, and I don't think he's made the full circuit connection of the mistake that he made and owning and taking responsibility for it. The guy we're going to look at briefly this morning, one of my favorite subject characters to talk about in Scripture is King David, because he was a guy that kind of lived the best of times and the worst of times. He was an example of many really good things. He also set a lot of really poor examples that we can learn from. The end result of David's life was that God looked at him and evaluated him and said, this is a guy after my own heart. I love this guy. And the reason, chiefly, is because David, when he made a mistake, would learn how to face those consequences and face them in faith, letting God do what God wanted to do and accepting some humility and moving forward. And I think that's such a great role model for us, especially in the culture that we live in today. So I'm not going to read the whole thing for you. You can go back and do that yourself. The story I'm pulling from is from 2 Samuel 12. Let me paraphrase the story for you, kind of set it up. Okay, here's the deal. He's the king. Kings back then, they were the king. You know, nobody questioned them. And during the springtime, kings were supposed to be off at war. If a king sent his army, and they always did, because spring is the season to fight wars, you know, because the weather's good, I guess. I don't know. But, you know, off the army went, and he stayed home. Stayed back at the palace, just kind of hanging out, bumming out. And he was up on the roof of the palace one day in the evening, and he looked over and spotted a naked lady. She was taking a bath over on top of her house. One thing leads to another. He sends the palace guard, says, I'm going to have you some of that, and invites the woman over, you know, invites her over. And, you know, they spend the night together. They have a one-night fling, and as a result, a pregnancy results. When he finds out about the pregnancy, he says, I've got to do something about this because, you know, I can't let this be found out. So he schemes this master plan to call the woman. The woman's name is Bathsheba, by the way. Her husband was Uriah. Uriah was off fighting the war that David should have been fighting. Uriah was in battle doing his job as a soldier. He recalls Uriah from the battlefield and brings him over to the palace and, you know, schmoozes along, and they have some ha-ha, some laughs, some kingly laughs, and gets him drunk and decides he's going to send Uriah home to sleep with his wife that night, because if she does that and find out later she's pregnant, then it's his baby and not David's, and, you know, his tracks are covered. Uriah, unfortunately, proves to be a problem for David because Uriah is an honorable man. And a soldier in those days would not come home on a break when their brothers in arms are still out in the field fighting and just go, you know, make merry and sleep with your wife. Instead, Uriah slept on the steps of the palace, refused to go home to be with his wife. David realized now he's got a problem on his hands because he can't get this guy to go home and make it look like it's his child. So he does the next worst thing. He takes it to the next level. David secretly writes a letter to Uriah's commander out in the field fighting the war, seals it up, gives it to Uriah, says, give this to your commander when you get there. Commander opens it up privately and reads it, and it's instructions for the commander to have Uriah killed in battle. Set him up, make sure that he's not going to walk out of this alive. He's got to die on the battlefield. And it happens. Uriah is killed. When the word comes back, David, being the good, benevolent king that everybody admires and respects, he goes to the grieving widow who's with child and shows his great king benevolence and brings her into the palace under his own arm and gives himself to marry her and take her as his own because of loyal Uriah. It's the right thing to do. And so he does, and he thinks he's gotten away with it. The problem is God wasn't very happy with what had happened, and God saw the events. He sees everything. And so God sends... Aren't you glad I'm not reading this? I mean, it's bad enough just listening to me yammer, right? Just think if I was reading this with these thous begats and shoulda, woulda, couldas. So God sends the prophet Nathan to go confront David to tell him that God saw what happened, been watching you. And so Nathan goes in, and he kind of tells a story, not unlike me. And he tells a story to David. He says, David, got a story for you. There's a rich guy, lives here. He's got 1,000 cattle, 1,000 goats, 1,000 sheep. He's got everything he'd ever want. And right next door was a poor man who was a servant. And the poor man had exactly one lamb, little baby lamb, fuzzy, wuzzy, woolly, white, blinking, blue-eyed lamb. And he'd raised this lamb from babyhood. I mean, raised it on his knee, bottle-fed the thing. It was like a pet. I mean, they watched TV together. It was just a little, sweet little baby lamb. You get the picture, right? A big house cat. And the rich guy had a bunch of his college cronies come into town, have a little party. And the rich guy, instead of going to his herds and flocks to get one of the animals there to barbecue, goes to this next-door neighbor, this poor guy with the one lamb, demands the lamb, slaughters it, and barbecues it and feeds it to his cronies. Now, as Nathan is talking to David, you've got to understand something about David. He was, by and large, a very good guy. He was, by and large, a very moral guy. And he was a commoner before he was a king. And when he was hearing this story, he was getting mad. And he finally blurted out, he said, this guy that did that, he needs to die for that. That is wrong. And that's when Nathan drops the bombshell, which we pick up, of course, in the narrative in 2 Samuel chapter 12. Nathan says, you're the man. And here's what God, the God of Israel, has to say to you. I made you king over Israel. I freed you from the fist of Saul. I gave you your master's daughter and other wives to have and to hold. I gave you both Israel and Judah, two countries. And if that hadn't been enough, I'd gladly have thrown in much more. So why have you treated the word of God with brazen contempt, doing this great evil? You murdered Uriah the Hittite and then took his wife as your wife. And worse, you killed the guy with an enemy sword. And now, because you've treated God with such contempt and took Uriah the Hittite's wife as your own wife, killing and murder will continually plague your family. This is God speaking. Remember, I'll make trouble for you out of your own family. I'll take your wives from right out of in front of you, and I'll give them to some neighbor, and he'll go to bed with them openly. You did your thing in secret. Now I'm going to do mine with the whole country watching. And then take a look at this next verse, because it's very important to see how David responded to this accusation. Then David confessed to Nathan, I've sinned against God. And then Nathan pronounced, yes, but that's not the last word. God forgives your sin. You won't die for it. But, and that's what I want us to focus on a little bit this morning. It probably doesn't show up very well, especially when it's read like that. But it wouldn't have been, you did this, you did this, you did this. I'm sorry. Okay, it's all over. It wouldn't have been that way. David would have repented. It would have been something that Nathan and God would have recognized to be genuine and legitimate. There was something there that happened that God recognized. David took full responsibility and was willing to do whatever it took to make it right. And that's when Nathan said, you're forgiven. God still loves you, but... And then the consequences were laid out. And not just in that meeting, but for the rest of David's natural life, really. So I want you to see something very important. You know, God didn't want to punish David about the mistakes that he made. He wanted to bless David, but he didn't want David wiggling out of the consequences either. And possibly wiggling out of a way for God to work through those consequences to help a lot of people out. So that's the big thing you want to see. To his credit, and I think this is great, you know, David accepted consequences graciously. He lived well with them. He worked hard to make sure that he didn't abdicate any further than he already had. And for a leader of that era, or any leader, quite frankly, any common person, that's extraordinary. So, you know what I think when I read David's story, and there's a lot of stories, it's not about his failures. That's not what makes this story interesting. Like I said earlier, we can turn on the TV and we'll watch stories about people's failures all day. Read the news. Watch the news. It's all about people's failures. The thing that makes this story so amazing is his courage and his humility to face his failures and to follow through with doing what needed to be done, the consequences. It's kind of like the message title, to come to truth, but also to embrace the consequences instead of either or, right? So, here's the lesson we get to learn, one of the lessons we get to learn if we want to apply it. First of all, when sin or mistakes or screw-ups turn into a crisis with consequences in my life or in your life, David's example would be this. Learn to live with it. Learn to live with it. Now, I'm not saying, I'll just put up with it. You know, my daughter said the other day, well, I did this, so deal with it. You know, well, she wasn't exactly, you know, inviting all of us to work together and process this as a family. She was basically blowing me off. And when David says, or when David demonstrates to live with it, it's a proactive, do what's necessary, do what God suggests, own up, pay up, and move forward. And that's what David proceeded to do from this point forward. Got a couple of quotes for you. Not too many, but just enough to make you forget the other ones and maybe remember one of them. Irving Kristol is an author. He said, "Being frustrated is disagreeable, but the real disasters of life begin when you get what you want." Think about that for a second. Millionaires, people that win the lottery, how many horror stories do we hear about them? Man, everything was good. You know, they lived in a double wide, you know, like I did forever, and then they win, you know, a multi-million dollar lottery, and their life is destroyed. Thought getting what you wanted was supposed to make it right. Well, no, it can be a problem. Many of you would know the name Don Shula. He's an NFL coach, famous NFL coach with the Dolphins. And he was also known as a follower of Christ, was known well within the Collegiate Fellowship of Christian Athlete circles, and spoke at a lot of conferences, influenced a lot of people for Christ. But he was also an NFL football coach. So you understand that has its challenges, right? That tend to be a little bit of an intense job. And so one time during a nationally televised game when the Dolphins weren't doing all that well, and, you know, I don't fault him because I'm a Cowboys fan and, you know, I've got the same problem as Shula did that day. But he was really upset, and the camera and microphone swung by right when he was letting a line of expletives fly. And it was broadcast on national, international TV. There was no delay button then. There was no, you know, wardrobe malfunction, you know, protocol. It was right there. And all of these people around the country that had trusted and looked up to and had bought books from and had used him as a role model, they were really upset. He got over 1,000 letters from people specifically complaining that, "Hey, you let that fly. My kids were in the room with me when you did that, and we look up to you." Now, here's where Don Shula did something amazing, I think. Every letter that was sent to him that had a return address, he handwrote a note of apology. It took him a long time to do it. And in each letter, he said specifically, "I value your respect, and I will do my best to earn it again." And in an interview later on, Shula said something that I thought was very useful. He says, "You know, there are only two ways to gain respect. One is to act nobly to begin with. And number two, when you fail to do that, make no excuses for yourself." Isn't that great? And that's an uncommon nobility. So here's David. He's in his palace room. He thinks he's got this whole thing taken care of. In comes Nathan, who's a friend, but also he's kind of a pastor. He's a, you know, minister of God. And Nathan, they're alone. Nathan confronts him. He says, "I know what you did because God knows what you did." You know, David had some choices. Number one, he could have had Nathan rubbed off, bumped out. You know what I'm saying? "You know it's too much. You're going to take care of you. Capiche?" He didn't do that. He could have, and was not uncommon. You know, I mean, a lot of kings did, you know, a lot worse for a lot less. He also could have blamed it on kingly pressures. "Yeah, you don't understand what it's like to be king, do you, Nathan, huh? It's easy for you to come in here and tell me all my problems. But I'm king, and it's tough. So get off my back. God, I just sounded like my daughter yesterday. That's amazing. It wasn't that bad." Could have also done this routine. I've seen this happen before. "Okay, you got me, and I did it. You're right. But you can't tell anybody. Because if you do, the whole country could unravel. Do you want that? Is that what you want? Do you? Well, do you?" Nathan's like, "Now this is my problem. I'm walking out. I got to, you know." He could have done any of those things. He could have deflected. He didn't do it. Here's something I want you to see. David, he faced the music head on, right? He made no excuses. He offered no defense. He manned up. And there were consequences, significant consequences. And I know that he knew in that moment when he said, "I'll do whatever it takes," you know, in his heart, he knew that there would be some significant consequences. You know, there's always a place where I like to talk about this, and I'll just talk about it briefly as kind of a sidebar. One of the consequences was that infant child that was conceived between Bathsheba and David died. And God said, "That'll be one of the consequences. This baby's going to die." I just want to take a moment to help you understand, in Scripture, both in the Old and the New Testament, there's a difference between what's a precedent and what is a principle. A principle is a lesson that you learn. A precedent is something that you can expect to happen over and over again. If I step off this platform and fall to the ground, there's a precedent in place. It's called gravity. If you do it every time, it's going to happen this way. In Scripture, this was an example of a principle. In other words, if you know somebody who had an infant die, it's not because of a sin. It's not because the child was conceived in sin or some grievous thing that mom and dad did, or if somebody's born with a disability that there's some kind of a sin issue. In fact, you know, the Jewish culture of Jesus' day believed that. And Jesus, throughout the New Testament, was challenging that and kiboshing that. No, that's not what's happening here. That isn't, you're missing a principle and trying to see a precedent. And this is an example where this infant dies that is a principle. And the principle is very simple. God was trying to teach and illustrate through this example that innocent people will suffer if we abdicate our consequences. And sometimes in our consequences, even when we tackle them, when we make mistakes, and we all make them, you know, it does have fallout. That's why we try to avoid them as much as we can. But it is a reality. So what are some of the fallout, I would call it collateral damage, that happened from David's mistake? Just listen to this for a second. Because when I studied this, I thought, wow, you could really play that out. First of all, for whatever reason, we have an infant that dies right away. Don't know why that is. We can ask Jesus someday when we see him face to face. But in the meantime, we know in that particular example, that was one of the collateral damage aspects. But then we have this honorable soldier, Uriah, who was murdered on the battlefield. Not killed in battle, murdered. And he was murdered childless, which was a tragedy in those days because there weren't any sons or children for him to pass on the family name. Now we have Bathsheba, and I don't know to what level she was culpable for the affair, but I think I'd make it 51% David, 49% Bathsheba at the most, all right? But the fact is, she had to bury a husband that she loved who was murdered. And she probably knew about the murder. And then less than 9 months later, she had to bury her infant child. Wow. Joab, he was the military commander that got the order to have Uriah killed. He was an honorable military commander. He was given an illegal and immoral command, and he followed through on it, and it diminished him as a man. He was asked to do something that he knew was against God's law, and it was immoral, and it was illegal in the country, but he did it anyway. He was asked to do it. He followed through, and part of Joab was left on the battlefield that day. Then we've got Uriah's fellow soldiers. You know what? Uriah wasn't the only one murdered that day, because in order for this little thing to get pulled off to where nobody would ever know that there was anything wrong, Joab sent Uriah's platoon, and many members of the platoon also got killed that day in this ruse to try to make it look like an accident. And so now we've got dead soldiers with families, mothers, fathers, wives, sons, daughters, aunts, uncles, friends, grieving the death, the senseless death of these soldiers that died in a battle that nobody can really explain. What was happening? And right on the heels of that, you've got the entire company army. You've got the entire Israeli army marching back off the battlefield going, what was that all about? We just lost some of our best guys. And it doesn't even make any sense, and nobody will give us an answer. The command set that up. You never set it up like that. You knew they get in there, they were going to get knocked down, and they did it anyway. Why did they do it? And nobody's talking. So the whole army was demoralized. And then you got David's extended family. From that point forward, the kingdom suffered. A lot of things went into play that day, all stemming from the day that David stood on the palace rooftop and looked at a naked lady. All these things cascade down from that one lapse of judgment and decision to move and to act on that lapse of judgment. I'm glad to say that, in the end run, David didn't dodge consequences. He did initially, but he eventually came full circle. He didn't cop an attitude. He didn't shift blame. He learned to live with the consequences as productively and proactively as he could. And I think that also played into his legacy when God calls him a man after God's own heart. God doesn't mean that it's because he's perfect and flawless. Far from it. He's a mess. But he tried to approach his mistakes with integrity and to learn from them and to not make other people pay the bill. All right, that's the first thing. You learn to live with it. You get what I'm saying by that. That there are ways of proactively trying to do that with our own mistakes. The second little lesson that we learn when sin or when mistakes turn into a crisis with consequences, we can learn something from it. We can always learn something from it. You've heard the phrase, a crisis is a terrible thing to waste. Well, consequences are a terrible thing to waste when we can learn something from it. And when we can grow and our character can be affected. One of our church theologians from 600 years back, a guy by the name of Richard Hooker, he said this. He said, affliction is both a medicine if we sin and a preservative that we sin not. And his point was that, the affliction or the consequences that we face still can be a good thing. I mean, it's unfortunate and it's not what we desire, but, those can be helpful things for us if we will embrace them and we will approach them with integrity. So you don't ever want to waste the opportunity to learn from the consequences that you and I face. So let me just kind of, as I wrap things up a little bit, let's put some practical application here. Looking at David's situation, what are some things we can learn that we can carry out of here with us today? First of all, we know from David's story that he suffered from an unchecked temporary lack of focus. He was up on the palace rooftop looking at naked ladies when he should have been out to war. He was bored. He was bored. He had too much time on his hands, and he wasn't doing what he was supposed to be doing. And as a result, he got into a situation where he was tempted. He followed through on the temptation. And then all these other things happened. And by the way, I would challenge every guy in the room right now. It's not exclusive to guys, but we live in a day and age where you can have unfiltered, unmonitored internet in the Palm Pilot, on the desktop and the laptop. We have satellite channels that we can find ourselves watching at all hours of the night without having any accountability. All I'm saying is, you better figure out how to manage that, because that's the very same thing that David found himself in the middle of. That was the equivalent. No accountability and boredom, unaccountable time on his hands. There'd be all kinds of things we could say for both men and women, but the fact is, I want to ask you a question. Think about this. How's your focus right now in your life? How's your focus? What are you doing with your life? What are you doing with your free time? We all need downtime and recreation. We probably need more of it than we realize. But what are you doing to better yourself? Are you reading books? Are you challenging yourself to stay busy so that your mind doesn't get bored, and pretty soon in boredom you start making decisions that just don't fit you and might even be harmful? How are you doing in your work, in your free time, in your spiritual life, in your church life? How's your focus? Okay, that'd be a little lesson for us. Here's the second thing. David suffered from a demand for instant gratification. He's the king. When you want it, if you're the king, you get it. And you got all kinds of people around you to make sure you do, because you're the king. Nobody's going to argue with you. And the fact of the matter is, kings typically did not demonstrate delayed gratification like we should and that we have to. So let me ask you a question. Are you content? I'm not asking, do you have goals or dreams? I hope you do, things you're looking forward to. What I'm asking is, are you willing to be content with where you're at in your life and in your finances right now, so that you don't circumvent an intelligent way of going about your future, demanding that it happen right now, jumping protocol that will be damaging to you or to your credit or to your finances or to relationships? Listen, we live in a culture right now, they will give you as many credit cards as your fat little wallet can carry. And they'll let you max them out. They don't care. Because if you want it, you ought to have it. In fact, the advertisements show you that if you did have their 18 credit cards, you could have all these cool things. So we live in a culture right now that the instant gratification, delayed gratification, forget about it. I want it now. And my question again is, are you in a place where you're content? Are you choosing to be content? Third thing that I want you to see about David's life. He suffered from indifference toward other people. Again, he's the king, so kings typically didn't get too involved in others-centered activities because they're the king. Everybody else pays attention to the king. And so here he is, living selfishly unto himself, too much self-centered activity, not thinking about Bathsheba. Maybe she has a husband. Maybe his husband has a life. Maybe they've got family. They've got relatives. Never even thought about that. Just headlong into the problem. Let me ask you a question. Are you reaching beyond yourself? Are you moving away from being a self-centered person to being an other-centered person? And we can do that through service groups. We can do that through our neighbors that we live around. We can do that in church. We can do that even at a grocery store if somebody needs help with something, to make a lifestyle of reaching beyond ourselves and living beyond ourselves to make a difference. Psychologists will tell you that one of the greatest ways to defend against depression and some of the other things that come with that, even loneliness, is when you extend yourself to help other people. There's something that happens in us because I think we're built for that, frankly, and there's a medicine in and of itself there. But are you reaching beyond yourself? Is there an element in your life right now that is beyond yourself? Here's another thing. Initially, at least, David suffered from dodging consequences. Obviously, he turned that around, but up to that point, he was making self-preservation his highest goal. Whatever it takes, the king's got to look right, the king can't look bad, and I'm going to do whatever it takes to make sure that that's the case, even if I have to hurt people. Let me ask you a question again. Are you dodging any consequences right now? Here's a tough reality, and I've learned this in my own life, both on the receiving end and on the dealing end of it. But when I dodge consequences that would naturally come to me for a mistake that I make, I may dodge paying the price, but somebody else is going to. You understand that? The consequences don't just go away. It'll be blamed on someone else, or the mess will be left for someone else to pick up. Oh, it'll be paid for, but it won't be me. And so my question again is, are you dodging any consequences? And can you accept the fact that in doing that, in dodging consequences, somebody else, either emotionally or materially, will have to pick up that tab for you? You don't want to leave that baggage behind you. Don't dodge consequences. It sounds crazy to say it, but embrace the consequences that you have to face in your life when you have to face them, and let God meet you in the middle of that. A quick little story, and then I'll be finished. 15 years old, just had my driver's license, and my dad restored vehicles and motorcycles and always had something interesting in the garage, and I never had a great relationship with my dad, and he died when I was 19, so I never really had a chance to enjoy the relationship with my dad that I'd love to have right now and would have loved through my 20s and 30s and into my 40s. But I was 15 years old. I had a brand new license. I didn't have a great relationship with my dad. And he had this baby Scout II, International Harvester Scout II four-wheel drive truck that he rebuilt from the ground up. Found it as a rollover wreck, straightened the frame, repainted it, put all this cool stuff. It was his baby. And I remember 15 years old, had my license for about a month. Went down to the basement. Hey, Dad, I got to run some errands. Can I borrow the Scout? And he didn't even think about it. He pulled the key out. He says, there you go. Went back to watching TV. Well, I went north of town in the Scout and found a big old field out in North Billings and started screaming across the field doing burnouts and donuts and power slides and all that great stuff, just having a ball with my dad's Scout. And as I was rounding a turn, there was a piece of steel-reinforced concrete, like a parking curb sticking out of the ground. Caught the front end of that rim on the left side, stopped the Scout and spun it around 90 degrees. And as I'm sitting there thinking, okay, what's just happened? You put it into drive and you start rolling the Scout and you hear that noise, and it's wobbling and it's shimmying. And even at 15, I mean, I'm not brilliant right now, but even then I could figure out something was very, very wrong. And so all the way home, you're thinking, okay, how do I spin this to where this isn't my fault? There's got to be a way to do this. I know. I parked it on the street. It was fine when I left it there last night, Dad. Maybe a car just kind of came by and jammed the rim in the front end. I don't know. It's hard to say. And the more I drove it, the more I thought, you know, even at 15 years old, I'm done. This is it. I got to come clean with my dad. And there wasn't anything brave about it because I was expecting the worst. And I came home and parked it in the driveway, and I went downstairs. And the thing about my dad is you could always kind of tell what mood he was in. At night, if you came home late, it was dark, you could always tell Dad was a little grumpy if you heard fizzing. Because he had an Alka-Seltzer somewhere in the dark. If you saw the bubbles in the moonlight, you know, you knew Dad was a little ticked. Well, he wasn't fizzing that night, but he was down in the recliner watching TV like he normally was. And I went downstairs and I stood by the chair and he looked at me and says, what's up? I said, Dad, I took the Scout north of town to that field area where you know, and I was burning donuts and driving up and down and rodding it. And I came around a turn and there was a piece of concrete curbing sticking out. It caught the front end of the thing. Dad, something really wrong with it. I've messed it up. And I'm sorry. I was working a couple jobs in. I said, I'll pay for it. I'll make sure I set up the repair. You know, I'll do whatever you need me to do. I'm very sorry. But it happened because I was out screwing around. Dad didn't say anything. He sat in the chair, looked at me, looked back at the TV, got up out of the chair, started walking toward the stairs to walk upstairs. I'm behind him like dead men walking, you know, going out to the execution field. And he walks outside to the Scout, and, you know, he's looking at it, and he drops down on the concrete, crawls underneath, and does a little bit of jiggling and moving like this, and gets up, brushes his hands off, looks at the front end, stands, looks me straight in the eye, says, well, the tie rod's bent, but I think we can fix it. And thanks for telling me. Walked back into the house, went back to the TV show. You know, I learned a valuable lesson then that, my dad didn't expect perfection from me. What he was glad to hear was that I'd be honest. And we would get the tie rod fixed. And I paid for it, by the way. Oh, I paid for it. And I got my little fingers greasy. It was actually a pretty good time with my dad in that season of time. So I didn't dodge anything, but boy, I tell you what, I learned a life lesson. And I've learned it about my dad. I learned it about friends, bosses, pastors, neighbors, spouse, family members. And the fact is, Jesus doesn't expect us to be perfect. What he wants us to do is practice honesty in faith, believing that by doing the right thing and acting honestly, he doesn't shun us for that, but he will come into the middle of that consequence and he'll bless us. And he'll strengthen us and he'll teach us something. And other people out there are watching our lives. And when we own up to a mistake and we own the consequences and not deflect or make excuses, no matter how messy it is, God comes in and does something supernatural. And he blesses us. And people are encouraged. We're always encouraged to see somebody do the right thing. It always stirs us on to greatness. And so I want to pray for you. I don't know where you're at in your life right now, or if you came through the door this morning and maybe there's something going on in your life. You know, only God knows that. But I know that if you're like me, as long as you have a pulse, you're going to screw up from time to time. You're going to leave a mess. And you're going to have a decision to make. Do I take care of this, or do I pass it off and walk away and hope nobody ever notices? Father, our prayer this morning is pretty simple. We don't have to wonder if we're going to screw up. We have, and maybe at this point some of us are, and we're going to many times. We know from your word that you don't condemn us. You don't demand perfection, and when we step out of perfection, shame on us. It's not that way at all. You know better than we know how badly we're going to screw things up at times. What you've asked us to do is be faithful enough to believe that by simply being honest about that, you'll come into the middle of it and help us to work through it in a way that's honorable, that brings glory to you and makes us better people. And by the way, leaves a good example for others watching us. Lord, by accepting consequences head on, we ensure that we're not making somebody else pay the price. And maybe we can't make all the problems go away, but God, we know that you'll honor us in that. You'll step into the middle of it and be gracious. And I know that there'll be someone here that maybe has had something going on in their life for a while, and they're not sure what to do with it. It's not that they don't want to, it's that they don't know where to begin. And my prayer for them, Father, would be that even before the day is over, you'd give them a fresh revelation about what the next step could be. Give them wisdom and knowledge. Help them to take that next step in faith and integrity to do the right thing. And if the consequences roll out before them, strengthen them in the middle of it. Help them. Walk with them through it. Don't abandon them. And at the end of it, on the other side, you'll be glorified and we'll be better for it. And so help us. Help us to live lives that honor you. Not perfect lives, but lives that honor you. And we'll be grateful for you as we go. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks.
Stellar.